Hello, and welcome to the Radical Fabulatorium. I'm your host, John Adam Ian. Okay, on today's episode, I sit down with Brad Roberts of the Canadian band Crash Test Dummies. We talk about their new single, Sacred Alphabet. We also talk about how they're hitting the road to celebrate their Christmas album, Jingle All the Way, which is a cool, quirky Canadian take on a bunch of Christmas and holiday classics. It's kind of unexpected, to be honest. I had never heard it until recently, and was pleasantly surprised. We also dive into what he's been up to in between writing. We talk a bit about him studying composition and counterpoint, dive into the masters of those techniques, like Bach from back in the 1700s. We talk about the recording process, and I get to pick his brain a little bit about his brother Dan, who plays bass in the band. And Brad kind of shares how Dan writes the bass lines. And since I'm a bass player, I found that pretty interesting. We also talk about the various connections the Crash Test Dummies have to the East Coast, which is actually where they're going to start their tour for Jingle All the Way here in November 2023. We also talk about the difference between harpsichords and pianos, which I thought was pretty cool. And we kind of dive into the philosophical topic of what their song Sacred Alphabet is about. Kind of like the universe before language existed, before sounds were kind of manipulated into words and syllables. So I thought that was pretty fun. Kind of right up my alley. All right, so without further ado, here's my chat with Brad Roberts of the Crash Test Dummies. Hello.
Hello.
Hey, Brad, how's it going?
It's going good. I'm so sorry about all the time it took for me to get to you.
Yeah, no problem.
I had to download the Google app. And
yeah, it's all good. Yeah, it's all good. I'm free all afternoon, so I'm in no rush at all, really, to be honest. So it's all good.
Well, thank you. You're very understanding.
Yeah, I try to keep it pretty chill, you know. We're pretty punk rock at the radio station, so that's kind of my ethos.
Okay, well, that's an ethos I can get along with.
All right, perfect. So you're coming to St. John here next week, the Crash Test Dummies, to perform the Jingle All the Way album, along with some other hits. Is that right?
That is indeed the case. So We recorded a Christmas album a long time ago, and when it came out, it wasn't very well promoted by the company that took it on.
Okay.
And I've always kind of regretted that. And so this year we decided that we would do a vinyl reprint of the Christmas record that we made.
Okay.
And that we would do a tour in which we, kind of relaunched that record into the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's got its own quirky flavor to it, you know? It's really kind of to me anyway, it's kind of like an unexpected Christmas sound, you know? It's a good blend.
Well, thank you for that. I take that as a compliment. I wanted it to be unexpected as well. We were really trying to stretch our wings and have fun with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, the production's gorgeous on it. Like, the arrangements are really nice and beautiful. So, but again, that sense of humor, I think, is very Canadian. Or it feels very Canadian.
Yes. Yes, it does. I think you're right about that. Good call.
And when you come, so I'll just tell the listeners, it's going to be at November 17th at the Imperial in St. John. You're also going to be playing some Crash Test Dummy tunes as well, right?
Yes, we are. We'll be playing all the old hits and all, some new songs and some deep cuts and... and that in addition to some of the Christmas carols.
Yeah, cool. And your new tune is probably going to fit right into the vibe of the show, I would imagine, Sacred Alphabet.
Yes, it really does seem to work well. I was surprised when it came time to put a new song into the set. You know, a lot of the time people don't want to hear music that they're not already familiar with. Mm-hmm. And it's hard to hold their attention with new material. But that song really holds everyone's attention, and it gets a tremendous response each night. So I've been very pleased.
Cool. So you find, the audience is kind of absorbing it. Nice, because, I mean, it's such a beautiful, quiet, haunting song. The audience seems to kind of dive into it and accept it?
Yes, they settle down and listen carefully, which is nice because it's a tune that sort of rewards a close listening.
I completely agree. The first time I listened to it happened to be in the morning. I kind of have a morning routine. I try to get up before the sun. I kind of like light some candles and read a book. So it's pretty dark in here. And then when I hit play on that song, it really, right out of the gates, it felt like I was listening to something like a little special, not to come off as like a fanboy, but I really mean that. It felt like it had a different energy to it.
Oh, thank you very much. That's a huge compliment. I'll take it.
I do. Yeah, and I do mean it. Anyone who hasn't heard it yet, Sacred Alphabet, I would go check it out. It's kind of a heavy tune, right? Like you're talking about a pretty philosophical concept in that tune, in the lyrics, aren't you?
Yeah. Yeah, it's all about language and the acquisition of language and the mystery of language, really. How meaning is affected. And it's, like you say, fairly philosophical, yeah.
Is there something that inspired the direction of that, for that tune?
You know, I've always been interested in linguistic philosophy and linguistic studies and the ideas behind the theories of how language came to be, and because it's a very strange thing, you know, we have this aptitude to speak, mm-hmm. and it's something that the other animals don't seem to have to the same extent. I mean, they do communicate, mm-hmm. but not like us. And where that aptitude comes from is a mystery to me. I think we all take for granted that we can talk because we do it all the time. But mm-hmm. the fact that we have language at all is quite incredible.
Mm-hmm. And do you think without language, do you think thoughts are possible?
That's a very good question. And it begs the further question, is language anything more than just sounds, you know? Or is it infused with meaning? Mm-hmm. And at what point does sound start to make sense, mm-hmm. rather than just being a sound?
Mm-hmm.
Those are all heavy metaphysical questions.
They're fun to explore. I actually have like a quantum like chemist coming on the show later, like in a week or two. So we kind of go down those rabbit holes in this show. So
that's great.
When I was reading the lyrics, it actually kind of made me wonder if you were trying to figure out what was happening before the Big Bang. That's kind of that's like, I know you're talking about language, but that's kind of where my mind went.
Yeah, I've had a couple of people remark that, and I take that to be a good sign. It's not really about before the Big Bang, as you say, but in a way it is. It's like at the beginning there was a void, mm-hmm. which is kind of a biblical reference. And in the void there is nothing. You know, it's like the universe doesn't exist yet,
mm-hmm.
and the universe comes to be born over the course of the lyric. So you're right, it does have a Big Bang Theory kind of a context to it.
Yeah, that's kind of where my, I'm a big fan of Carl Sagan, and he had a saying, we are a way for the cosmos to know itself.
That's a great saying.
So that's kind of what it's like, the cosmos consciousness has given birth. The cosmos gave birth to consciousness, so it can kind of like, yeah, study itself.
Yes, that's a brilliant notion.
So let's go back to the Jingle All the Way. Is that was recorded in the Magic Shop? Is that right?
I'm trying to think of where we recorded that. If you say the Magic Shop, then I believe you. If I would have to have the album credits in front of me. It was so long ago that we made that record. But the Magic Shop makes sense. I made a couple of records in the Magic Shop. It was a great place.
Yeah, it's no longer operating anymore, I don't think.
No, I don't think so either.
And actually, I just want to let everyone know, like, I went on to Amazon to look up the Jingle All the Way album, and like, there's like a used copy selling for like $100, but you can actually buy it directly from your store online, right? Like your website?
Yeah. Yes, you can.
Okay.
I'm surprised to hear that there's used ones going for that much money, but I guess they're hard to come by.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it is hard to come by. So I just thought, and same with eBay. If you jump on eBay, like instead of listeners going to track it down that way, just go right to your website and pick it up that way.
Yeah, absolutely.
So,
and you can get the vinyl now.
And yeah, awesome. Yeah, the vinyl. Very cool. It's kind of nice seeing the vinyl and physical media still hanging in there compared to all the streaming services.
Yes. I find it quite amusing that there's this kind of vinyl and even cassette renaissance.
Yeah.
Cassettes are just such a terrible format. You know, like they play back at the wrong speed and usually a little too fast and make you sound like a chipmunk.
Oh, really? So what you hear on the cassette isn't what you would have heard in the final mix?
No, as a matter of fact, cassette machines are notorious at not playing exactly the right speed in a way that, say, albums are not, and CDs are definitely not.
Okay.
Because those little revolving things that turn the tape heads are just not 100% accurate.
Okay.
And so when I listened back to our own first record on a cassette player when I first got a copy of it, and I was dismayed because I was like, it's the wrong speed. It's too fast. And it was just because the cassette player was playing it back.
Interesting.
Speed.
Huh.
There was nothing wrong with the actual recording.
Okay. I don't think I've ever heard of that before, but I guess it makes sense as it's spinning, it has to be adjusting the speed that the tape is moving across the heads or whatever.
Yeah.
Maybe. Interesting. So you, I know cassettes are kind of popular in the punk rock scene. A lot of my buddies who are in punk bands, cassettes have been kind of going on there for 5 or 10 years. It seems like big cassette renaissance.
Yes, it's a very interesting phenomenon.
So are you looking forward to hitting the road and getting back in the on the East Coast? I know that's where the tour is starting. Is that right?
Yes, it certainly does start on the East Coast, and I am looking forward to it. We haven't been on the road for a few months now, and I get itchy feet for that.
To be out on the road and interacting with fans, performing on stage.
Yeah, I love it. I really like what I do.
Do you have a favorite? Do you have a favorite part of being on the road?
Well, the performances are definitely the highlight. I mean, to be honest with you, even though I like touring, most of it is incredibly boring. Like 90% of your time is spent either traveling or in a hotel or doing sound check or doing press, you know. And it's all kind of a tedious grind, but then 8 o'clock rolls around and the show starts, and then it becomes a different story altogether. And then it's lots of fun.
Mm-hmm.
And then after the show, you have the anticlimax of going back to your hotel room and settling down and trying to get to sleep so that you can get up the next day and drive for 4 more hours to the next place.
Yeah. Is it hard to come down after a show? Like to settle down?
Yeah, it is. Depending on how exhausted you are.
So it goes back and forth between exhaustion, or I guess I was imagining like being hyped up, you know, like filled with adrenaline.
Yes. Yeah, there is that. There is that.
And so you'll be going down through like the U.S. and the East Coast, I guess, of North America in general?
Yes. It's quite an extensive tour. It goes throughout the U.S. and Canada. We're actually in Canada. We're going out west as well, and we're going as far north as Whitehorse.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Which I'm really looking forward to.
Yeah.
Because I don't get a chance to get that far north very often. And it's a trip up there.
Yeah. Yeah, that's quite a drive.
Yeah.
I would my instinct says they probably don't get a ton of touring acts up there, but do you have any idea?
I think you're probably right. But I'm not absolutely sure. I wouldn't want to speak on behalf of Whitehorse and misspeak, as it were.
Yeah, misrepresent. Yeah, true. Maybe you could, I know I'm kind of jumping all over the place here, but I've got, I know you've got some connections to the East Coast, so I wouldn't mind filling my listeners in about your connections here. I know you spent some time out here and you were involved in an accident. I don't know if you feel like retelling that story again.
Well, I did live for a little while in Argyle on the Southwest Shore. And I did indeed have a terrible car accident out in the middle of nowhere. And I was rescued by a local paramedic who just happened to hear my car wreck. It was really an incredible, thing for this guy to have heard my car crack up, and he came and helped me out of my car, and whereupon it exploded like in a movie. Just boom. And it burnt down to nothing. And I had a badly broken arm and a scratched up face, and I was very lucky to get away with my life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that sounds intense.
And then... Then I met a woman in America, my wife, and I wanted to take her to see the East Coast, but I didn't want to revisit Argyle, so I took her up to Cape Breton.
Okay.
And we stayed in the village manse in Bedeck.
Okay.
And we made some friends up there that still come to our shows and that we still talk to. So we've got lots of East Coast connections. Our management as well, Wayne O'Connor, mm-hmm. Is from Halifax. And I seem to know a lot of people from out East. Our keyboard player, Leith Fleming Smith,
okay,
is from Halifax.
Oh, cool.
He just joined us in the last couple of years.
Okay.
We needed a new keyboard player. And he's a Halifax native, and he's tremendous.
Cool. He's driving well with the band?
Yes, incredibly well.
So when you were out at in Cape Breton, is that when the Cape Breton Lobster Bash series kind of came around?
Yes, exactly. That's exactly right.
You mind, did that ever become a full release, or those were just release singles through your website?
Those were just singles. You know, I meant to write one every year for every Lobster Bash, and then one year they didn't have the Lobster Bash.
Okay.
The series waned.
Okay. Because that was a kind of a cool tune to, I just came across on YouTube, someone had uploaded it, and I thought the production on it was really, really interesting, kind of this acoustic song, but it kind of had this like warm distortion. And maybe that was the uploader, but it kind of had this like nice warm sound to the whole song.
Oh, thanks, man. I appreciate that.
So Ellen Reed, of course, will be back. The full band will be back. Like, your brother's going to be back playing bass as he always is.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Dan will be on bass and Mitch George is on drums.
Okay.
Ellen Reed sings backups and Stuart Cameron plays guitar.
Okay. I find Dan's bass playing to be quite, I would say it's pretty underrated, to be honest. Like he picks and chooses his moments really well. I'm a bass player, so I guess I could kind of nerd out to his bass lines where he picks and chooses melodic moments and when he just kind of holds it down with the drums. He seems like quite the underrated player.
I think so too. And a lot of people remark on what a great bass player Dan is. I can tell you what he does when he writes a bass line to a new song.
Sure.
He learns the melody of the song first on the bass. And then he writes the bass line.
Okay.
Which is why his bass lines are a combination of, you know, laying it down with the drums and being simple and getting that stinking groove going.
Yeah.
On the one hand, and then on the other hand, playing very melodically at times.
Okay.
You know, and of course, when the bass gets melodic, it tends to stick out because the bass is not there to be melodic most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
But as you say, he picks the spots.
So you must send him completed songs, and then he obviously studies your melody before writing.
Yes. Yes.
What's the what's the process like there, writing, like sending demos back and forth?
Well, I used to write melodies first, on the theory that if the melody sounded good by itself and was captivating, then whatever words you put to it, you'd have a winner.
Okay.
And then I don't know, about four records into writing, I sat down one day and very spontaneously wrote a lyric and set it to music afterwards.
Okay.
Which was the first time I had done it in that order.
Okay.
And it worked out really well, and I've been doing it that way ever since. I write a lyric first and I set it to music.
When you write
the lyrics? And then I put it on a demo, usually with just acoustic guitar and maybe a drum machine. And the rest of the band contributes whatever they want to contribute from there.
You leave it wide open for them to interpret it the way they hear it?
Sometimes I have specific ideas about what I want, and sometimes I just let them do whatever they like.
Okay.
I think I've been probably more inclined to let them do whatever they like since I've gotten older.
Okay. And is that a trust thing or a change in your taste, your ears?
It's more like a change in attitude. I used to feel like I had to button down everything myself.
Okay.
I used to feel like I had to button everything down myself, and now I'm a little bit more able to be relaxed about it. So I think it's a change in my temperament.
Change in temperament, yeah. Which can only come with time, I suppose, really?
Yes. Yeah.
Do you get feedback from them on if they enjoy the new process or any opinions coming the other way?
As a matter of fact, we've been employing a process that we've never employed before for the last couple of songs. Sacred Alphabet was recorded remotely, which is to say, I put down the piano and the vocal in New York City, and then I sent out those tracks to the various band members, and they all came up with their own parts, recorded them, sent them back to me.
Okay.
And then we put them all together and mixed them.
Okay. And did you get to pick and choose? Did they send multiple takes?
They did.
Okay.
Well, actually, not all of them did. Dan just sent the finished product, which was great. Stuart sent multiple takes for us to choose from. I kind of feel like multiple takes are nice in that you do get some choices, but I also like it when people just deliver the product and I don't have to think about picking and choosing.
Okay. Just solidifies it. The paradox of choice sometimes.
Yes, exactly. The paradox of choice.
Seems like a good idea until you have too much to choose from and then it never ends.
Yes.
So I know you took a break from songwriting. So what do you do with your creative energy when you're not always songwriting?
Well, I've been studying composition recently.
Okay.
Classical music styled composition, counterpoint.
Okay.
Specifically. And that keeps me pretty busy. I'm also learning to play piano, strictly for my own sake. Mm-hmm. It's nothing I'll ever do on stage. And I play things like Bach. I've been working on his little preludes and the inventions.
Okay.
And so I keep busy. I try and keep busy when I'm not writing songs because it's easy. I get bored very easily.
Okay. So you got to keep moving, keep working on something fresh, or keep learning. Yes. Right? Sounds like you like to keep learning.
Yes, that's exactly right.
Could you dive into counterpoint a little more? I'm sure there's plenty of listeners who don't really know what counterpoint means or is.
Yeah, sure. In popular music today, what we hear is not counterpoint. What we hear is a melody sung by the singer that is supported by the harmony provided by the band. So there's a melody on top, and then there's harmonic support underneath. Now, in counterpoint, instead of having a melody on top and support underneath, you have multiple melodies going on at the same time. Usually one of them is the focus, and the other melodies are secondary. But nevertheless, they are melodies. It's not just old-fashioned country song bass line kind of stylings where you play the root and the fifth. Mm-hmm. It's much more involved. It's much more melodic. And so the idea of stacking together melodies to create harmony is the focus of counterpoint. There's probably people out there that could define counterpoint much better than I just did. So I ultimately defer to them, but that's what I make of it anyways.
Is there anything you did specifically to train your ear to get used to listening to that kind of music, since it's so different from contemporary?
Yes, I did. First of all, I studied the music with a teacher. And secondly, I learned how to write counterpoint, which is a process in itself. And so now when I'm reading Bach, for example, who was heavily into counterpoint, I know what's going on in a way that I didn't before. It's a completely different approach to music than what we do in popular music. So it's a brand new territory for me.
And do you get quite a few insights from studying? Because that's hundreds of years old, that music, right? Is there any other insight you kind of plucked out?
Yes, in Sacred Alphabet, for example, I wrote the piano part contrapuntally, and so it's the study of that genre has led directly to the production of music in my case.
Okay. And does contrapuntally, is that another word for counterpoint?
Contrapuntally is the adjective form of counterpoint, yeah.
Cool. Yeah, so that's a totally different, because in modern music you have, like what you said, the main melody, but now in counterpoint you I would imagine a new listener might think the melodies are distracting each other or fighting each other or like dividing your attention.
Well, you know, it's interesting. The way Bach puts together his counterpoint, it isn't distracting. All of the voices complement each other.
Okay.
And if anything, they work in confluence rather than working against each other. And one of the great joys of listening to that style of music is that you can simultaneously hear several melodies going on. And it's not that hard to pick them out, you know? Unless Glenn Gould happens to be playing it at a million miles an hour, which he likes to do, and then sometimes it's hard to pick up. Not to say that I don't love Glenn Gould. I listen to him all the time.
Yeah. Yeah, I was going to ask for recommendations for anyone listening where to start at. You know, I know Glenn Gould's name is thrown out here and there, but also I'm not really into that world, but he seems maybe like a love-hate classical performer because, anyway, did you have any suggestions?
Well, Glenn Gould, and, you know, now that you're asking me for names, they're escaping me. Angela Hewitt is a Canadian pianist that I admire a great deal. And there's a couple of others that play Bach really well. Andreas Schiff is one of them.
Okay, cool.
But if I was going to listen to Bach, I would definitely go with Glenn Gould.
Glenn Gould, yeah, cool. Do you find it interesting? Think so. Bach is that the 1600s? Is that when Bach was around?
The 18th century, so more like the 1700s. He was born in the 1600s, but he lived into the 1700s.
Okay. I just find it interesting that people kind of bunch classical music all together, you know? So like you might think of Bach and then Chopin, when really there's like hundreds, could be hundreds of years between these composers, but in a lot of people's minds, they kind of get clumped in one.
Well, and the term classical music, it often gets used in a generic sense just for all music that was written in the past. Mm-hmm. Not all music, but, you know, a lot of it. Mm-hmm. And in fact, classical music refers to a particular era, the era of Haydn and Mozart and Beethoven.
Okay.
They're the three sort of supreme classical composers. And the classical style was a response to the Baroque style of Bach. And Bach was considered, even in his own day, rather old-fashioned.
Oh, really?
Yes, and counterpoint was considered an out-of-date way of composing. But he kept it up in the face of the shift in style. And the shift in style was really one where classical sound is much more, much less complex. It doesn't necessarily have several melodies going on at the same time all the time. The lines are a little bit more clean.
Okay.
And the textures are simpler.
Okay.
Not to say simple-minded or anything like that. It's just different.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of where it evolved into after Baroque.
Yes, exactly.
Would that have been, instrument-wise at that period, would they have had the piano, or would it have been harpsichord music?
During Bach's day, they did invent the piano, but it was very early days, and Bach tried a few of them, and I think the reports are that he didn't think a great deal of them.
Okay.
Having said that, Bach has played not just on the harpsichord these days, but also on the piano, and it sounds great on the piano.
Yeah.
And it might not be the way people heard it when it was originally composed, but it still sounds great.
Mm-hmm. And I mean,
some people are purists and will only listen to Bach on harpsichord because that's the instrument that he technically wrote for.
Okay.
A lot of the time, or at least generally speaking, keyboards. You could play it on the a lot of his stuff on the clavichord as well, or a manual organ without pedals.
Okay. I know, I mean, modern listeners wouldn't be familiar with a harpsichord if they're listening to contemporary music, you know, they wouldn't, probably not many purists would even I guess not many modern listeners might not even understand like the difference between a harpsichord and a piano.
Yeah, well, they're quite different instruments. The piano has a sustain pedal, and it has the ability to be soft and loud. Whereas harpsichords tend to be a little bit more uniform in their tone and volume.
Mm-hmm. And that they're more of a plucked instrument. Is that right?
They're a plucked instrument rather than a hammered instrument. Exactly. Good call.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's interesting. And again, a lot of people just don't probably... They might see the keys, you know, in front of it and think it's played the same way, but it isn't.
Yeah.
Yeah, everyone can check out... the show coming up at the St. John, the Imperial Theater in St. John, November 17th. Crash Test Dummies will be in playing their Christmas tune, Jingle All the Way, but also they'll be playing some of their greatest hits and the awesome new song, Sacred Alphabet.
Yes, we will. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. So then after that, you're hitting the road. This is your first, St. John's the first show of the tour, right?
It is.
Okay, perfect. Awesome. Well, thanks a lot for joining me today, Brad, on the Radical Fabulatorium. I appreciate your time. I really do, and I'm pretty excited to see the show.
Oh, I'm so glad to hear that. And thank you very much for the interview. I really appreciate your time.
Yeah, no problem. Anytime.
All right. Thanks, man.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks, Brad.
Thank you.
See ya.
All right. Bye-bye.